Hello everyone, my name is Ken Berkey. This is
Jamie Ellsworth.
The Jamie Ellsworth, and welcome to our Sunday morning service. Obviously, we're recording this part of it. We're at the Orangeville Food Bank, and we've had an amazing day.
Yeah, today we were hustling today. We were serving a lot of families. The need is going up. And with that, if you're interested in volunteering with us, we would love to have you. It's such an amazing experience. Just send in, there's a link in there. Just, you know, send us an email and I will be happy to get in touch with you and get you on board with our team here.
Yeah, thank you, Jamie.
Jamie's kind of, I love it.
Not only is she passionate, but you've kind of owned this and volunteering.
Yeah.
And a lot of us are volunteering on Thursdays, but for people who work, they say there's a big need on Wednesday nights.
Wednesday nights, and there's also an opportunity on Monday mornings as well. So Lots of opportunity here. We can get you plugged in what works for you.
So, all right. Yeah. Awesome. Well, hey, no, you can come through. See, people are still working. We're not working anymore.
Yeah.
Now, what a day. It was hot. It was very hot, but it was an amazing day. Thank you, everyone at the park. We raised over $1,000 for Powerhouse just by you
excellent.
Purchasing meals. Thank you for your generosity overall as Live58 Church. We are just moving forward in awesome ways.
It's incredible what's happening here.
Yeah, and so the other thing is today we are going to be talking about gratitude. And actually, I'll give it away. I'm going to talk about how gratitude is the deepest form of faith. Mm. That gratitude is what really grows our faith. And because preaching this message has really made me be more intentional every day to just say, okay, God, I have so much to be thankful for. What are you thankful for?
I am thankful that I found a church that spoke to my heart. And you've been a big part of that. And it's changed my life to have that God-filled hole. You know, there's a hole in there. There's something missing. And then you find, and whatever church is, it's not a building.
Yeah.
It's people. It's a community. It's, you know, we know it's not a building anymore. You know, it's online and it's getting together with like-minded people and serving what we do here and, you know, your messages. I take it. It fills my heart. And I try to go out and be a better human with it. So I'm full of gratitude every day. I'm such a blessed individual, and it's the simple things.
Yeah.
It's people, it's sharing your faith, smiling at those that come through and are down.
Yeah.
And giving kids Otter Pops through the windows.
I was the hero today.
He was the hero.
Everybody's working. I'm just handing kids Otter Pops. And in the summertime, it doesn't matter.
It was awesome.
Summertime.
Yeah, the adults even got really excited about it.
They were excited. So I'm thankful for all of you, this church, this community of believers. And like you said, it's not about a building, but we are doing so much ministry and community in small ways and in safe ways. But, man, it's exciting.
It is.
It really is exciting. And so I hope... As we get ready to start the service, and I'm also thankful for our worship because
absolutely,
they don't listen to anything I say, and that's why they're so good.
Yeah.
But I hope you enjoy the worship today, and we're going to get ready for the service as we talk about gratitude being the deepest form of faith. And again, we're going to ask Jamie to lead us in prayer.
All right, Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the goodness that you've helped with these people at the food bank. Please open our hearts to hear Ken's message today and just fill us with that attitude of gratitude and help us pass it on to those that might be lacking a little. Lord, we just are so grateful for all of the blessings that you have given to us. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Enjoy the service.
The same God that never fails will not fail me now. He won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God that's never late is working all things out. Working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift you up. fails will not fail me now. He won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God that's never late is working all things out. Working all things out. Holy, yes, I will lift you up in the lowest valley. And yes, I will bless your name. Holy, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy. And all my days, holy, yes, I will for all my days. Holy, yes, I will. And I choose your praise to glorify, glorify the name of our names. Nothing could stand against. I choose to praise. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you, Jesus. Holy, there beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
Sing worthy.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. You're so worthy. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
Oh, my Jesus. Sing his name.
Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever sing. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Sing holy, holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes. Beside you, open up my eyes and
Give thanks for the good days. When the traffic lights all turn green, when promotions come and bad habits are broken. Give thanks for warm meals and the company of friends. Give thanks for undeniable blessings and clear direction. When the music floods your soul and the worship songs flow without effort. Give thanks for coffee and clothing and hope that the two never mix. Give thanks for the mother who battles daily in prayer. For the father working three jobs. For the brothers and sisters who build blanket forts and read bedtime stories. Give thanks for sons and daughters and all our family who remind us of what truly matters. Give thanks for the stranger who holds the door open and the lifelong friend who holds you when life is broken. Give thanks for the hard days, for the phone call that brings life crashing down, for jobs lost and friendships fallen into conflict. Give thanks for the anger that reminds us we are human and the tears that express more than words can ever fathom. Give thanks, though the pain is overwhelming, your energy spent, your spirit fallen, and your only option is to fall to your knees before your Holy Father and cry out, God, please help me. For in that moment, His power is made perfect. His love is made evident. He becomes your strength, your comfort, and your salvation. Give thanks for the power of redemption, from Genesis to Revelation, for the endless promises of a God who would rather sacrifice His Son than give up on His children. For nail-pierced hands, for brilliant dawns, for the cool touch of rain and the simplicity of a quiet day. For all things great and small, let us give thanks.
Well, Pam Lantzmeyer is an equities investment broker whose office is located in downtown Chicago. For a year, every morning, she would encounter a middle-aged homeless woman in a worn coat soliciting spare change in front of an old brick church. This woman would greet everyone with a smile and a pleasant good morning. Pam almost always gave her something. After a year of this routine, however, this woman in the worn coat disappeared. Then one day, she was in front of the church again, still wearing the same worn coat. As Pam reached into her purse for the usual donation, the woman stopped her. "Thank you for helping me all of these days," she said. "You won't see me again because I got a job." She reached into a bag and handed Pam a glazed donut. She had been standing at her old spot waiting not for a handout, but to thank the people who had helped her during those difficult days. There's an old Chinese proverb that says, when eating bamboo sprouts, remember the man who planted them. I want to read you an amazing story about gratitude. It's found in Luke chapter 17, verses 11 through 19. It says that while Jesus was on the way to Jerusalem, he was passing between Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered the village, 10 leprous men with leprosy, stood at a distance from him, and they raised their voices, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." And when Jesus saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourself to the priests." And as they were going, they were healed. They were cleansed. Now one of them, when he saw that he had been healed, turned back, ran back to Jesus, bowed at his feet, and glorified God. And Jesus looked and said, "Weren't there 10 that were cleansed?" And then he looked at the one man who had come back, full of gratitude. And he said, "Stand up, go, your faith has made you well."
The thesis, the theme of this message is this. Gratitude, I believe, is the deepest form of faith. Gratitude is the deepest form of faith. We start with 10 men who have the worst disease of their day. The physical ramifications are horrendous. Leprosy attacks the body, leaving sores, missing fingers, damaged limbs. In many cases, the initial pain of leprosy gives way to something even more terrible, and that is the loss of sensation and nerve endings. And when that happens, people actually, over time, lose limbs. The disease can take up to 30 years to run its course. During that time span, entire limbs can simply fall off. Several years ago, I took a team to India, and we were partnering with an organization over there where we wanted to help start a home to rescue young girls who'd been sex trafficked. It ended up actually happening, and it was awesome. But while we were there, we traveled to the city of Hardwar, where people would take a pilgrimage from all over to cleanse themselves in the Ganges River. Devout believers felt like if they would go to heaven by getting their salvation after a dip in the sacred ganja in Hardwar. And I'll never forget this. This was only a few years ago. Lepers lined the streets, hoping someone would help them down to the river. I think about how bad this disease was, physically. The smell of rotting, decaying flesh, overwhelming the senses of smell. But there was something worse about this disease in Jesus' day, as it is today, and that was the emotional pain of a leper. The emotional pain of a leper was even worse than the physical pain. Because a leper was removed from his family, from his community, the leper was then an outcast, an untouchable. There could be no contact with their grandchildren, with their children, with their spouses. And so lepers tended to roam together looking for food, and because they were untouchable, they would yell a lot, asking in loud voices for someone to feed them. And yet on that fateful day, 10 men encounter Jesus, and they hear him say the most unusual thing. They yell, "Have mercy on me." They scream it at Jesus, and he responds, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." Now, the local priest had duties other than leading worship on each Sabbath. He was also known as the health official. If a person was healed of leprosy, it was up to the priest to declare, to test the body, and then to declare that this person was clean, free of leprosy. And in such cases, at that point, it had to be done by the priest. At that point, it would be fine then for the leper to go see his wife again, to hold his daughter again, to work again. But the priest had to give the okay. Now Jesus, this is where the story gets interesting. Jesus says to these lepers, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And these guys look down at their bodies, and their hands are still mangled, and they're still missing limbs. Another one looks at him and his skin still has sores. In other words, all of these men were no better off than they had been 10 minutes earlier when they had first spotted Jesus. And yet, they head off in search of the priests. Nothing had changed, but they obey Jesus. What does Hebrews 11:1 say? What is faith? It's the confident assurance that something we want is going to happen. It is the certainty that what we hope for is waiting for us, even though we cannot see it up ahead. And on their way, these guys are healed. On their way, a hand reappears. A crutch is thrown to the ground because a leg has grown back. Skin begins to clear up. The smells are gone, and these 10 guys begin to yell with those loud voices, but they're not loud voices of desperateness. They're loud voices of celebration. They break into cheering. They race off into the distance, not believing that their nightmare is finally over. But in order for the miracle to happen, these men had to start walking in faith before their circumstances changed. You see, you and I cannot wait until the problems are over to start walking in faith. You can't say, "Lord, as soon as there's enough money, I'll get my finances in order." You can't say, Lord, if you'll just solve this problem, then I'll start following you. You can't pray, Lord, I'll give you thanks when my problems go away. God says, love me in spite of your failures. Trust me in spite of the seemingly lack of resources. Celebrate me in spite of the depression. Say no to the temptation while it's still difficult. Praise me in the darkest of nights and in the worst of circumstances. You see, this is the nature of God. A God who loves you so much, he'll give you the opportunity to be thankful when nothing about your circumstances gives you that motivation. Because if we praised God only on the good days, only in the best of circumstances, it would not be faith at all. That would be more like a business arrangement. You see, one of the reasons that this is such an important topic is this, that gratitude is the deepest form of faith. Some of you are in difficult circumstances right now. And what awaits you today? What awaits you this week? I mean, it's tough right now. Serving at the Orangeville Food Bank, handing out food in people's cars and their trunks, and they're driving by and we're talking to people, and so many people who've had jobs for decades are losing their job. It's tough. It's tough. And these times are forcing the question. They're forcing the question, will we be grateful in spite of difficult circumstances? And if so, if you are, then you have experienced faith. Because gratitude is the deepest form of faith. Jack Hinton is a pastor in North Carolina. And he took a group of people down to the Caribbean for a missions trip. Yeah, you heard me right. The Caribbean for a missions trip. Sounds rough, doesn't it? But there's a lot of poverty and pain that the cruise ships don't show us down in the Caribbean. And as part of the week's experience, their host took them to a leper colony on the island of Tobago. While they were there, they had a worship service in the chapel for all the people experiencing leprosy. And Pastor Jack is standing there getting ready to lead worship, and the lepers just come in, and he's just overwhelmed by the brokenness. And so finally, when everybody got settled in, Pastor Jack asked, does somebody have a request for a song? And in the very back, a lady with just a nub of an arm, filled with leprosy. Her face had no nose, no lips, just bare teeth, but she raised her bony nub of an arm, and she asked with a quiet, shaky voice, could we sing Count Your Many Blessings? And Jack replied, I will never sing that song the same way again. You see, gratitude really is the deepest form of faith. Let's go deeper in this story. One man came back to Jesus. 10 got healed. One guy came back and praised God. He was grateful. He was public about it. The scripture says he was loud. He was loud coming back to Jesus. Why was he so loud? I believe this. It wasn't just because he had a loud personality. Anybody here live with someone or know someone who's just naturally loud? My daughter Larissa and I are known in our family as the loud ones. My wife says, I talk too loud in public. Several years ago, my wife and I were in LA and we were at a restaurant, and a guy came in nicely dressed, but he had one of those three-stranded comb-overs like this, and it was wrapped around trying to disguise the baldness. And I am a connoisseur of comb-overs just because because it's such beautiful artwork. And so I'm staring at this guy and I just blurt out, what an amazing comb-over. And the guy looks at me and I put my head down. And he walked away. My wife said, did you mean to tell the whole restaurant about that? Or were you trying to use your quiet voice? This guy had been forced to yell as long as he had had leprosy. But he had yelled begging. But now he didn't have to beg anymore. Now he was loud because he was grateful. He didn't care what people thought because his life had been radically changed. This man was loud because he was overwhelmed by gratitude. People who know, let me say this again, people who know they've been radically saved are like this. The Pharisee stands all sophisticated at a distance from Jesus, believing his goodness comes from within, while a woman weeps at Jesus' feet because she knows the love and the redemption of her Savior. And Jesus says this, whoever is forgiven much, loves much. And I would say whoever is forgiven much, thanks much, and often and loudly. I have learned this, that broken, hurting, desperate people who are overwhelmed by redemption lead the way in gratitude. The first time I ever spoke in Washington, D.C., I spoke at a predominantly African-American church, and the worship was so rich and so deep, and I'm on the front row, and I know I got to go up to speak, but the music just overwhelmed me, and I was just an emotional wreck, and I went up on the stage, and I began to speak, and I just began to speak on God's grace that is offered to anyone and everyone, and especially to those who feel they've done too much to be accepted by God. I was talking about God's unfailing, patient love that beckons us back to Him from our life of brokenness, hurts, and failures. Right in the middle of my talk, a gentleman in the front row who had been crying through the whole message jumps up and starts screaming and runs down the middle aisle. And as he's running towards the back door, he's yelling, "Jesus loves me! Jesus loves me! Jesus loves me!" And he opens the back door and he runs into the street. Well, that never happened to me before. So I just look around and go, yep, Jesus loves him. About five minutes later, the back door opened and he returned and he ran back down the middle aisle yelling, "Jesus still loves me. Jesus still loves me. Jesus still loves me." And he skipped and he hopped and he jumped back to his seat on the front row. After the service, I got to pray with this man who was still animated. This happy smile, tears of joy, tears of boogers running down his face. And he told me this, I'll never forget. He said, "Ken, I'm one of the biggest sinners in this neighborhood. Everyone knows that. I've been in gangs. I've lived on the streets. I've done drugs. I've had no self-worth, purpose, or hope. And then you told me tonight that Jesus still loves me. Jesus still loves me," and he kept saying it over and over, and he hugged me, and when he walked away, he was floating on air in gratitude. Jesus still loves me. I looked down, boogers on my shirt, but I loved every moment of it. He was overwhelmed by grace. He was overwhelmed by grace, and people who are overwhelmed by grace are overwhelmed by gratitude. Like the tax collector standing in the shadowed corners of the temple, beating his chest, crying out, "God, have mercy on me, I'm a sinner." People who know they are broken are the ones who come to God full of gratitude and are ushered into his redemptive healing arms. And let me just say this, this makes religious people a little bit nervous. Religious people work so hard at looking dignified and well put together that they miss out on the healing touch of God. In 1994, my first year of being a senior pastor, the church started welcoming in broken, hurting people into our services. The rawness and the honesty and the loudness of their confessions of who they were and how God had taken them out of darkness and replaced them with light and with grace, it was making the more established, well-rehearsed religious people nervous. One man so disturbed by the loudness of the gratitude, he told me this in disgust. "I wish it was the way it used to be." Well, the way it used to be was a few dozen people properly dressed, coming to church, judging the world, thanking God that they were not like them, and then going home feeling justified. And so I told the man, I said it with a really nice voice. Now inside I was boiling, but I said it with a really nice voice. "No thanks. I never want it to be the way it used to be." Because gratitude is the deepest form of faith. Let me take us a little bit deeper into the story and then we'll be done. This is a part of the story I didn't understand until a few years ago. One leper came back. One caught himself in the midst of celebration with the other nine, and he returns to Jesus. Now, this is significant because he reversed his steps. He put his family on hold. He put the priest on hold, so he hadn't even been declared clean yet. That's probably what I would have done first. But this guy goes, "No, priorities. I need to go back and be grateful." He reverses his steps, puts the priest on hold, and he comes back to the cause and the source of his celebration. His thankfulness and his decision to return changed everything. Let me tell you why. Because of this man's gratitude, something more miraculous happens to the one guy than the other nine. Let me just say this, a lifestyle of gratitude is a lifestyle of salvation. Let me go back to the story real quickly. The scripture is very clear. All 10 men are physically healed. They're all physically healed, all 10. But in this last verse where Jesus says to the one guy that comes back, rise and go, your faith has made you well. That word well, I always assumed, yeah, he got healed, everybody got healed. No, that word well is a different word. It's not a physical well, it's a spiritual well. In fact, it's the word sozo. Your faith has made you sozo. Everybody say sozo. Sozo, S-O-Z-O, sozo. I want you to remember that word. It's not a medical word. It's a word that means salvation, sozo. Paul described what would happen to a person who publicly professed Jesus as Lord and Savior, and he used the same word, sozo. He said, if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved, sozo. Say it again, sozo. And Jesus says to this very thankful man, willing to follow God before his circumstances changed, to worship God before he was declared clean by the priest, before he returned home, Jesus pronounces a complete healing on this man, not just physically, but spiritually. His faith saved him. Sozo. A lifestyle of gratitude is a lifestyle of salvation, friends. That's why the theme today is gratitude is the deepest form of faith. Meister Eckhart said this. Oh. He said, if the only prayer you said was thank you, that would be enough. Wow. Gratitude. It's the deepest form of faith. You know, I'm reminded of one more thing in this story, and we're always reminded of this. As Jesus has touched us in the midst of our disease, in our brokenness, in our leprosy, as he has healed us, Jesus asks us to touch those around us who are broken. He wants us to touch those so that they can be healed. We are reminded this morning that we are those lepers, but we are also reminded that we are now the body of Christ, and we are asked to touch those in the world that the world says are untouchable. And when we touch them, they can be well. They can be saved. Sozo. Let me close with this. I want to just look as much as I can right at you. I want you to lean forward. I want you to take this very personal right now. No abuse has scarred you so badly that Jesus won't touch you, hold you, restore you, save you. Sozo. No sin has made you unlovable. Jesus longs to call you his friend and stand beside you. It was his death that paid for your sins. Sozo. No fear has disqualified you. No problem has put your life on hold. No failure has negated his love for you. Sozo. No exceptions, no qualifications. Will you today let his loving touch heal you and cleanse you? Will you let his touch heal you and cleanse you? Will you run to him? Will you run to him with reckless gratitude so that you can be saved? Sozo. And church, all of us, will we this week praise him in the good times and the difficult times? Will we thank him in certain times and in uncertain times? And will we touch those who need God's healing touch? Because gratitude is the deepest form of faith. Let's worship together. Let's just give God all of our worship and all of our gratitude right now. And when we come back, I'll pray.
come and have your way, Jesus. Chains will be bound here now, Jesus. You change everything. Lives healed.
Well, gratitude is the deepest form of faith. And you know what excites me about this story and about our opportunity as followers of Christ is this week, as we practice gratitude, we can change somebody's day. I would encourage you. I would encourage you to thank the people you need to thank. I would encourage you each day to wake up and thank God. I was thinking how much influence we have if we're just grateful. You ever walk into a room and somebody walks in and they're angry and then everybody kind of gets angry? Or somebody walks into the room and they're worried and then everybody starts worrying? Somebody walks in and they're full of fear and everybody starts fearing? What if we just walked into rooms filled with gratitude? I really think it could change. It could change people's mindset because we have so much to be thankful for. So thanks for being with us today. Before I pray, just remember to follow us online. We have devotionals and information, upcoming events, home groups that are expanding. And again, if you want to be a part of our home groups, just go to the contact on our website, Live58 Church, and say, I want to be in a home group as we're expanding throughout the region. And also, I really can't say this enough because you're making it possible. So many of you, your generosity and giving. It's allowing us to have influence and to be able to bring hope, not only just locally, but all over the world. So thank you for your generosity. Three ways to give. As always, you can give online, through texting, and to the P.O. box. We have such an opportunity this week to just to practice gratitude and to grow our faith. So let me pray, and then we'll be done. God, thank you for this day that you have made. We will rejoice. We will be thankful for all of your blessings. Thank you, God, for saving us. Thank you, God, that we get to be a part of a community of believers where we get to serve and love and celebrate and bring hope to the world. Thank you, God, that you will never leave us or forsake us. Thank you, God, that you guide and direct our lives. So, God, may we be a church filled with gratitude. And may that be our prayer. For if our only prayer is thank you, that is enough. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.